Well, good morning, West Side. We just wanted to tell you that we miss you and that we love you, and we wanted to tell you
Happy Easter!
Good morning, West Side. Happy Easter from the Clerks.
West Side, how you doing? We're doing good. Love you guys. Happy Easter. Bye.
Hi, West Side. I believe that God is knitting a masterpiece in our hearts this Easter Sunday of His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and defeated the grave. Blessings, Doug.
Happy Easter from the Browns.
We miss you.
We love you.
Bye, West Side. Bye.
Hello, West Side. We miss you very much. We want to wish everybody a blessed Easter. We love you.
See you soon.
Stay safe and healthy.
Happy Easter, West Side.
Happy Easter.
We are so happy to be in ministry with you, and we miss you. This season has shown me how much we love and appreciate all of our friends, you, and can't wait to be with you again soon.
This is the day the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it.
That's right. See you soon.
Bye. Have a wonderful Resurrection Day.
Amen.
Well, good morning, Westside, and happy Easter. I am so excited that we get to worship Jesus together today. He's alive, and Hebrews 7 says that he's able to save completely those who come to God through him because he always lives to intercede for them. He does that today still for us. Let's praise him for his greatness and all the things he has done for us. We praise you, Jesus. Says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess to Jesus Christ, you, our Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Yes, you are. So worthy of praise. Let's sing out together. He's coming on the clouds.
Bow down. And every chain will break, his broken hearts declare his praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Open up the gates.
So open up the gates, make a way before the King of Kings. God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? No one. Who can stop the Lord?
Sing that in your home right there. Sing it.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Oh, just think of that. No one.
Who can stop the Lord? There is no one who can stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord? Oh, yeah.
Come on.
Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every bow before him, yeah. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before him.
Bow before you now because you are the risen Savior. Yes, Jesus.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin. Lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life. I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he paid for. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. Oh, when death was arrested, my life began.
Our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground.
He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him.
He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering.
Like one from whom men hide their faces, He was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted.
But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed.
We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, he did not open his mouth.
The oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished.
He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had not done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth.
Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days.
And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand after the suffering of his soul. He will see the light of life and be satisfied.
Because he poured out his life unto death
and was numbered with the transgressors.
For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
Oh. I asked the elders to read Isaiah 53. The whole passage is overwhelmingly beautiful. But verse 13 says he would look upon his suffering and be satisfied. Now let that soak into your heart for a minute. He would look on the empty tomb. He would look on all the things that happened at the end of it, and he would see it as beautiful. In Hebrews, it's described like this, that for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despised the shame, and is seated at the right hand of God. As we celebrate Easter together, let's celebrate it, because it is the most satisfying, beautiful, joyful experience that we know of, the resurrection.
Dear Lord Jesus, we just come to you now, and I just ask that you would be with Pastor Tim as he presents to our church the Easter service. In thy heavenly name, amen.
Thank you, Larry. This Easter service, I hope you're ready to hear lots of stories, because I'm a storyteller, and I'm just going to tell a whole bunch of stories. First of all, I want to start off by saying, I have always been an associate pastor, and associate pastors never get to preach in Easter service. So this is my chance to get to preach in Easter service. Another thing I want to say is I love to hike. And AJ's filming this right here, and I went hiking with AJ the other day, and it was such a joy. We went back up on the dunes, way off to the back of the dunes, and had a great time. I'm going to talk more about that in a minute, but I love to hike. And I love to especially hike mountains. So I was just thinking about them the other day, the mountains I've hiked. Mount Washington, Mount Whitney, Torrey and Grace, Evans, Long's Peak, 3 times, Pike's Peak, Elbert, twice, Lincoln, Cameroon, Boss, Democrat, Sherman, Quandary, Mount Marcy, and many, many more mountains, including some wild and crazy volcanoes in Guatemala. But the mountain I want to talk to you about right now, it's kind of sacred, and I want to go there. Fact of the matter, I want to drag AJ off with me to Arizona, and I want to go to this mountain because it's a mountain that's sacred to me. It's part of the San Francisco Peaks, and the name of the mountain is Humphrey. And when I was a young man, I was at this mountain with some youth leaders, and we were off hiking up, and we're going to hike for a few days and then climb to the top of Mount Aarons and Mount Humphreys, which are the highest mountains in Arizona. And as we hiked along, there was a drought in Arizona, and there was no water, and everywhere we were supposed to find water and replenish our water, there was none there. So we had run out of water. We'd gone a whole day with no water. We got up the next morning. It was going to be either climb the mountain or leave. And my youth leader, and by the way, I wasn't the most spiritual kid. Don't think that. Pastor's kids either turn out really good or really bad, and I was kind of on the dark side in that time in my life. And we had gotten into like this big circle, and we were praying, and I was thinking, this won't do any good. We are wasting our time praying. I'm thinking this, let's sing Kumbaya and head down the mountain and the survivors can tell where everybody else is at, right? And I fully intended to be a survivor. And we are there praying and they're praying fervently for God to supply water so that we can climb this mountain. And I'm thinking it's ridiculous. And from in back of me, I hear a woman's voice. And it says this, "Hi, how are you all doing?" And I look back and there's a horse with a ranger on it. And then her next question out of her mouth is, "You want water? I got water. Fact of the matter, there's water near here. You want to see water?" And she took us to water. It was fresh. It was wonderful. Well, I had no idea it was so close to where we were at. We just didn't know where it was at. And then we filled up with water and we went to climb the mountain. Well, at that time in my life, I was a little bit more fit than everybody else in the group. And I took off. I was just a young guy. And the leader said, "You can hike the mountain at whatever pace you were going." And I got going and I got way ahead of the rest of the group. I was a good mile ahead of everybody else. So now I was climbing up Mount Humphreys all by myself. And as I was hiking up Mount Humphreys, it became a place of repentance for me. I was thinking thoughts like this: there is a God, and he answers prayer. There is a God, and he does listen to us. I was such a place of repentance about all of the unbelief that I had allowed to happen in my life. And as I got up to the top of the mountain, it was snow covered. I remember there was mountain goats up there, and me and the mountain goats had the top of the mountain to ourselves up there till some other people came in. About maybe a half an hour later, other people showed up. And that was a place of repentance where I looked and finally put it all together and I believed. Let me read John 20, where you'll see the same kind of aha moment. Let me read it to you. "Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early." So this was an early morning run. Listen to this. "While it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb, so she ran. And she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, which is John," we're reading from the book of John, "and the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.' So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb, both of them running together." They're running along. There's a lot of running in this passage, which makes it something I love very much. "But the other disciple outran Peter." I have to stop right here. Peter was the oldest of the disciples, right? So it was a different age group. Never mind. For an old runner, that's a big deal. Anyway, I'm in the 60 and above age bracket now. And reached the tomb first. "And stopping to look, and he saw the linen clothes lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, followed him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen clothes lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lined with the linen clothes, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw," and listen to this, "and he believed." When he saw the empty tomb, he believed. So today's message is about those aha moments when we look into the empty tomb and we believe. The first thing I want to mention is that when we see the empty tomb, the resurrection changes everything. I took AJ out on a hike and I hiked him all the way to the back of the dunes, because in the back of the dunes, there is a really sacred spot for me. I call it the boneyard. If you go out and you go over this dune and you go up there and there's these, ghost forests, and there's a shelter back in there. Not that long ago, over a year, I had taken somebody else out there. His name was Reese Eisenhart. Just a young man. And the reason we went out there together is because I've been praying over him and praying over him, because he had been fighting cancer and he was declared cancer free. And we went out there and we were out at the dunes, and we're going to put up a picture here for you in a second. And we went out the dunes and he loved it. He laughed. He enjoyed it. And then he said, "I am going to stay here till the sun sets." So we literally sat there for like over an hour, waiting for the sunset. Well, last July, Reese Eisenhart on a Sunday morning was suddenly, in a moment, called home. A sudden cardiac event ended that young man's life at age 26. You know what that empty tomb means to me? That Reese went from this life to the next life. I want to say to you, the empty tomb means resurrection of everybody we lost in Christ. It means that everyone who's died that knows Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior is waiting for us in heaven. And I have so much invested in heaven. So much invested in heaven. And I am so thankful for the resurrection. The second thing I want to say is when you get to the empty tomb and you believe and you see, you should rejoice, right? You should worship. You should be excited. You know, you should be just overwhelmed with joy. Now, after my accident and I started getting better, eventually I began to run a little bit, and then I made a goal of running a half marathon. And I joined the Traverse City Track Club training group and began to train to run a half marathon. And every Saturday morning I would get out and I would run with these people. And, you know, I would start off by running maybe 30 minutes, then 40 minutes, then 50 minutes. And then I was ready to run a half marathon. Well, Craig and Mark, which are buddies of me, joined me that day at the Bayshore Marathon, and we all ran. And we were running along, running together. They were both much better runners than me, but we were running because, well, we were going to celebrate the fact that I could run a half marathon. Well, we crossed that finish line, and I remember it to this day. Somebody handed me a bottle of cold water. Right? And then they put a medal around my neck, and they put a medal around Craig's neck, and we celebrated. It was something incredible and joyful. Well, the empty tomb is more than that. That was just a wonderful moment. The empty tomb is an eternal moment. Let me tell you about another moment I celebrated. Going back to Arizona, I spent one summer, the summer of 1977, I spent inside the Grand Canyon, working there. I worked at an Indian reservation in the Havasupai Canyon, and it was a wonderful, fun spot. And I became really close buddies with the Indian teenagers. These guys, they love me, I love them. We hiked together, we swam in the waterfalls. There's this outrageous, look it up someday. Havasupai Waterfalls is one of the most beautiful waterfalls on the planet. It is gorgeous, right? We would swim in that, we would goof around, have a great time. Well, the summer had come to an end and they said, "We have a gift for you, Tim. This is what we want to do for you." So there's two plateaus in the Havasupai Canyon, and they took me up to the top plateau. And they took me up to this great big rock. And they said, "Tim, we want you to stand on the rock, but don't get off." I want to say, when Indian teenagers tell you not to get off the rock, don't get off the rock. I stood, it was a big rock. I'm standing on this rock. They all leave. And they're gone. I can't see them. They are completely gone, and away they're going. And I'm waiting on the rock, waiting on the rock. And their order, "Do not get off the rock. Do not get off the rock. Good, do not get off the rock," kept going through my brain. And suddenly the ground began to shake and to rumble, right? Well, up on the first plateau in the Havasupai Canyon is a wild horse herd. And the teenagers had gotten in back of the horses and stampeded them at the rock. Yes, they gave me a goodbye stampede, and those horses are coming straight at this big rock. I'm standing on the rock. They are thundering along, horses, right? They come right at the rock, and then when they get to the rock, they split like a river going around a rock, and on they go. I got a stampede as a goodbye gift. Coming up behind the horses are my buddies running. Oh, they're running like only they could run. And they are flying. They jump up on the rock. They run to me. They tackle me. They lay me on the ground. And we are laughing and giggling and laughing and rejoicing. It was one of the most outrageous, joyful moments of my life. Filled with laughter and joy. At the moment I can think about it right now, I'm going, yeah. They gave me the gift of a stampede. Jesus has given me the gift of eternity. Now, I just want to say something. I got to stop right here. And I hadn't planned this in my message, but I'm going to do this. Maybe you are watching and the empty tomb isn't something you've claimed. What I want to say about that, maybe you need to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, right? Maybe right now you need to put your faith in Him. I remember when I did that, I prayed a prayer that went something like this. Dear Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sin. For the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I put my faith in you as Lord and Savior. Pray it with me. Dear God, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I put my trust and faith in you. I thank you that you died on the cross for my sin and rose from the dead to give me eternal life. I put my faith in you. If you did that, please contact me. I would love to call you up and pray with you. Another thing that the tomb gives you is a new identity. Going back to being a preacher's kid, one of my problems was that I did some bad stuff in my life. All of us have those moments. Satan is that accuser. He accuses day and night before the throne, right? He is that evil one that says, look what you did, look what you did, look what you did. And he accuses us over and over and over again. Zechariah 3, it pictures, there's the high priest Joshua, and there is Satan, and there is the Son of Man, and he's accusing him and accusing him, and then the Son of Man says, I rebuke you. Is not this like a stick that is snatched from the fire? And then he says, put clean raiment on him. Change his clothes. Read Zechariah 3 today. You'll thank me for that. He gives us a new identity. Well, I struggled with that bad identity that I used to have. One of the things that I get to do quite often that I love is go on missionary trips. So my church had been sending me to Uganda. We had been down there working at a children's orphanage, this grand children's orphanage, and we're helping with a project to build a school there. I had been there. And now I was going back again, and I had an all brand new team. I'm the only face that was part of the old team. I got a new team of people, and we're going to this orphanage to work it in Uganda, outside the city of Sida, Uganda. Just picture a grand orphanage of about 700 kids. So when you pull in there on a bus, the place goes crazy with excitement and joy. And I remember they're dancing, beating drums and welcoming us, but I am getting the big welcome because they know me. I'm back. And they say the following thing. Musamba's back. Now, prior to this, I said, dear God, give me a new internal name. The empty tomb means that my sins disappeared, that my brokenness disappeared. All that evil that had been part of my life was gone, but I still was identifying by it. I said, give me a new internal name, because my old internal name was, God, you're disappointed with me. Like I'm God's disappointment. But I'm not God's disappointment. I said, give me a new name. And now these little kids were coming up and calling me Musumba, Musumba. By the way, nobody else was being called Musumba. I was the only Musumba in the crowd. Musumba, Musumba. I had no idea what they were talking about, but I loved it. Musumba. So I asked somebody, what are they saying? And they said this. Musumba means shepherd. They said, the shepherd's back. I said, that's my identity. I am a new creation in Christ. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. I identify with the empty tomb. I am living in the resurrection power. As I close this, I want to read a quote by N.T. Wright, who's far wiser than me, talking about this exact scene from John 20. Easter gospel is to have your mind and your heart torn open in quite a new way, so that the new day can come flooding in despite the fact that you thought it was time to go to bed, and so that you can be set off running to see what it's all about. There's no time to lose. Easter is about running when you thought you'd be still sleeping. It's about believing what you thought you'd never could imagine. It's about living in a way you never had dreamed possible. It's about Jesus returning from the dead and launching the new creation in which all is forgiven, all is remade, all is reborn. That's our Savior. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we come before you, and we are a new creation in Christ. The old is passed away. The tomb is empty. It's gone. All there is folded linen in the corner, and our Savior is up and going. And we should be running to our Savior and rejoicing and claiming our new identity in Christ. May we do that. May we celebrate this Easter with great joy. In your mighty name, amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Come on now.
Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Has lost his grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost his grip on me. Have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence,
roaring lion, declared the grave has no claim on me.
Let's sing that again.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory.
Praise you, we praise you, we praise you. Thank you guys for worshiping Jesus on this beautiful Easter day. He is with us, he is in us. Let him work through you this week. Be his hands and feet, loving our neighbors as we go. God bless you guys. Hope to see you soon.